Well, Danzu, it's good to be able to meet with you, or at least connect with you this way again over the airwaves. It's Tuesday morning here at the church, and I've been reflecting on our last Sunday morning gathering. As you know, we've had the extraordinary blessing of being able to be outside this summertime, and it's a blessing that's unique to our church in some ways. Plenty of our churches in Toronto don't have these kind of options, and they don't have the kind of people who are coming around and being sure that things are set up and take down like so many of you have been helping with. Just a brief encouragement here, if you could help us a little bit more, as these things tend to go on, folks tend to drop off with the amount of help that there is in these things, and that's certainly understandable. But where there's still work to be done, there's still service to be offered. And so if you can think about coming a little earlier on a Sunday morning or staying a little bit later and helping to break things down or helping to set things up, you know, that would be an encouragement to those who do that week upon week. But the interesting thing about being outside like that is that there's a certain sense of freedom, isn't there? That we don't have to sit in the separate pews the same way. We do need to keep our distance outside, but we feel like we're together, and there's a freedom of being able to congregate as a congregation together. There's something about not having to wear our masks outside, and there seems to be a sense of, hey, we really are moving forward. You know, we're going to the next level where something's changing as this COVID craziness continues to move away from us and back to the way we are used to meeting together as God's people. But you know, the interesting thing is that this coming Sunday, we're going to be here indoors in our church sanctuary as David from Desert Rain brings the word. And because a number of people were away, we knew this in advance, and we said, okay, the ability to be outside is really going to be hampered. Let's just come inside for a week. We can meet in our auditorium here with the proper safety protocols. We can have a bit of an overflow into the basement if we need that. And so God, again, has given us ways to meet. But one of the things about coming back into the church that we've realized is that since we've upgraded some of our technology over this pandemic time, some of our computer projectors and that kind of thing, we've realized that because we have added certain things, they don't all work as harmoniously as we'd like or consistently as we'd like. And so one of the things Renillo and David Hallett have been helping us with to try to figure out the best way to move forward. The struggle is that when you try to diagnose a computer problem, any of you who've had this know what it's like. Either people seem to think it's really obvious, all you got to do is, and then you do that and it doesn't work, or it's, oh, you know, you need a whole new system. You know, none of those things are going to work together. You got to spend 10 grand. And both of those extremes are not usually particularly helpful. And people like David and Renillo, who really oversee that area, can know how to diagnose and say, well, let's try this. Let's try this. Okay, let's try this situation. Let's turn that off and turn this on. Let's sort of remove a variable and then see what the result is. And then you introduce that variable and see what that result is, and is it the result we're looking for? Where we are right now is that the computer that we have just simply isn't sufficient to run what are not one old PowerPoint projector, which we had before the pandemic, but now a brand new one a few months ago, as you remember, and then that other one going to the back, and to have the one out in the foyer. And you know, we've got to address that. But in addressing it, what you realize is it's hard to understand and it's hard to believe how you come to a proper diagnosis. There's a whole bunch of us who have different experiences with this. And we do tend to lead with, well, the problem is, well, maybe that's the problem. Because someone else who's been working on it, like I have, hears that and they say, well, we actually did that. Well, are you sure you did this? Well, are you sure? And you think, okay, to diagnose those things, you actually have to have a concentrated time that you work it through and try to figure out what the problem is, introducing different variables. Because the trouble with something like this is it might work for a minute, but this person over here who says, see, it works, doesn't realize that the problem is not that it works for a minute, but that it works for a 2-hour service. And that's part of the problem. And so we're working on that. And these guys are quality guys. They know what they're doing. They're gonna figure all of this out. But you know, as even as I talked through it with him, I realized that, you know, diagnosing a problem requires that you're going to come to the solution that the expert, if you will, the person who knows what they're doing, the person who really sees the big picture, that you're willing to come to the conclusion that they are. I remember there's been times over these last number of years that we've said, well, we have to do this. Someone will say, well, that's too expensive. I say, okay, but that doesn't mean it's not the solution. Well, that's too much. We shouldn't have to do that. We've never had to do that before. I've never thought of that. We've never done it that way. We're good at Baptists like that, aren't we? But you may say it's too expensive, but say, but that's still the solution. So now we have another problem is how do you pay for the solution? Rather than saying you need another solution, because we've come to the solution in one example. When I say that, friends, it gets me to thinking about gospel diagnostics. And they aren't easy. They aren't easy for any of us, especially when we seek to share our faith with others. We have dear friends, as you do, who are not walking with the Lord, but who love us and know that we love them and want to help them diagnose their condition so that they can come to the conclusion and the solution, however expensive it might be, however inconvenient it might be, however we've never done it that way, we've never thought of that before, it may be, we still want them to come to the conclusion that the gospel brings. So for instance, you come to the third chapter of the book of Romans, and you read in verse 10, none is righteous, no, not one. Which means the person you're speaking to is hearing God himself through his word say, you're not righteous. And everybody thinks they are, at least in the simplest definition of righteousness, living rightly, doing rightly, believing rightly, living for what we ought to rightly live for. But the Bible says no one does that. No, not even one. No, not even that person. No one understands. No one seeks for God. Boy, we've been living in the last 30 years of the seeker movement. The Bible says no one's seeking until God first seeks them. We know that's the background, but it's tricky, isn't it? You keep reading, all have turned aside because they have become worthless. No one does good, no, not even one. And it's this all-encompassing diagnostic that the Bible gives us of the human condition that because we've never thought of it that way before, because the solution seems way too expensive, and the path forward just doesn't seem like a path that we've ever considered, it's really hard to receive such a diagnosis. And you move down in chapter 3 to verse 21, and he begins with the solution, but now the righteousness of God has been manifested or displayed apart from the law, although the law and the prophets bear witness to it. Verse 22, the righteousness of God through faith in Christ Jesus for all who believe, because there is no distinction, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. And that seems to be the summary statement of the diagnosis, isn't it? And when you heard that, perhaps that was a verse or the concept of that verse that God used to draw you to himself, to reflect who you were, to display who you were not. It's not easy to receive that. And just like we don't want the diagnosis that we got to get a new computer or we got to get a new graphic card or we got to get a new whatever it might be, we don't like that. We don't think we should have to do it because we never thought of it that way before. Everything's worked fine up to this point. My life's been just fine up to this point. It's really difficult, isn't it? Especially in a North American affluence in Toronto here, of the life of affluence and ease and comfort that overwhelmingly the people who you and I come in contact with, that's where their life is. And so part of the challenge with that diagnostic is that it presents a problem to get to the solution. Because when the ultimate diagnostic is all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, my pastor, Kevin Dibley, as you know, we worked together for 10 years in Thunder Bay. Kev said that for all have sinned is the past tense, and fall short of the glory of God is present tense. We all have sinned, and we all are continuing to fall short of the glory of God. It's not just something that's happened in the past. It's often how sin is dealt with, right? Look back and repent of what you've done. It's a repentance, a turning from the way I'm living right now, which means there's no one good. There's no part of my life that's seeking after God. There's no part of this that I kind of understand, as Romans 3, 10 and following will tell us. But you see, God enters in with the solution nonetheless, just as we have to when we're diagnosing our computer issues here. This is where we've come to. If this is a solution and this is the cost, then we've got to stare at it and deal with that. Because he says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, but verse 24, and are justified, made right, made righteous, considered righteous in the eyes of God, and are justified by his grace as a gift through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus. Justified by his favor upon us as a unmerited present gift to us. Boy, that doesn't hit us right. If I've made the problem, I want to make the solution. If I've messed it up, I want to be the one who fix it. If I'm the one who's contributed to making a mess of my life, I'm the one who will clean my life up. That's not the diagnostic that you've just contributed to it and therefore you can fix it. No, no, the diagnostic is you've so messed it up that you are helpless now as a consequence of that sinful state to find your way to God without God. That's the truth of it. Redeemed, justified as a gift of his grace through the redemption, through redeming. The redeeming. That's a financial word. Remember, that's money exchanging. I've redeemed the computer chip for this much money. That's what I've used my money for. I've redeemed it. Jesus has redeemed us, bought us. Whom God, Jesus Christ, whom God put forward as a propitiation, fancy theological word for atoning sacrifice, the one who has paid the debt in our place, propitiation by his blood, that's what he's bought us with, to be received by faith. Which means I trust that what I require is what you offer. And what you offer is what I can receive because you offer it as a gift. This was to show God's righteousness, because in his divine forbearance, he'd passed over foreign sins, former sins. It was to show his righteousness at the present time, so that he might be just and the justifier of the one who has faith in Jesus. Do you understand the ultimate problem there? God's righteousness was not being shown in my life. And so he saved me so that it would be. Which is why he does it. Oh, I thought the whole problem was that the computer display wasn't working. No, no. The problem was that the way we're trying to broadcast our services to people here wasn't happening. Yes, there's a computer issue, but why? Who cares if it doesn't work? We care because it's not giving us the result we're looking for. Why does God care that our lives are not seeking after him and not being lived in conformity to him? Because his righteousness is not on display where we are not in a right relationship with him. Friends, that's the diagnostic of the gospel. And that's the solution he points us to. And there may be people, I dare say there are people in a church our size, of folks who've never really understood that. And I know that's hard. I appreciate that's hard because it calls for submission and it calls for humility and it calls for surrender. It calls us to wave the white flag. But friends, that's the real diagnostic. And even if it's so expensive that it's going to cost us our lives to lay them down at the feet of Jesus and say, I'm so sorry, I have not lived for you and I beg you to cause it to be so. That's an expensive solution. But if that's the solution which the Bible has given, and it indeed is, then that's the only way to see that not only we are saved and find the joy that we are scrambling to find everywhere other than Jesus, but so that his righteousness would be on display in our lives. All right, friends. Talk to you again soon. Cheers.